Welcome to City Cinematheque, where the art and pleasure of the movies are the subject of serious discussion. I'm your host, Jerry Carlson, and I teach film studies at the City College of the City University of New York. Today, we continue in our series, Masters of Film Noir. We're screening the 1950 production, The File on Thelma Jordon, directed by Robert Siodmak and starring the incomparable Barbara Stanwyck. If you thought she was a complicated femme fatale in Double Indemnity, wait till you see her here. We'll be talking about femme fatales, noir, and a host of other things after today's screening. Joining us will be my CUNY colleague from Brooklyn College, Professor Foster Hirsch, author of The Dark Side of the Screen, Film Noir. Now, join the company of Thelma Jordon in this classic noir. Welcome back to City Cinematheque. I hope you have enjoyed this opportunity to see one of the high points of late 40s, early 50s, transitional moment in film noir, but a kind of masterpiece. And from one of the great masters, Robert Siodmak, and from one of the great actresses of film noir, Barbara Stanwyck. It's a hit all the way around. And to talk about this, it's a pleasure, as always, to welcome back to a longtime friend of City Cinematheque, my CUNY colleague from Brooklyn College, Professor Foster Hirsch, who's booked in more than 50 years of teaching cinema at Brooklyn College. Many of our viewers may know Foster from his many works, but particularly relevant to our discussion today is his classic textbook, The Dark Side of the Screen, Film Noir, which is widely used here and elsewhere in the world as a key text about film noir. Foster's the author of many books, but what I would like to talk about just for the moment is Hollywood and the Movies of the 50s. And the subtitle is?
The Collapse of the Studio System, The Thrill of Cinerama, and The Invasion of the Ultimate Body Snatcher, Television.
All right. And at more than 600 pages?
Close to 700.
Close to 700.
And don't ask how long I worked on it, but there it is.
Okay, well, in your 39 years.
Yes.
Yeah, like Jack Benny. No, and a film, a book, rather, that is just about everything you need to know about Hollywood and the 50s, and congratulations on its publication.
Thank you. Thanks.
So let's go back to the very dawn of the 1950s. As you reminded me, but I'll steal your line. I'm going to do it.
Okay.
As you reminded me, this film was actually introduced, it first played in the first week of January, 1950. So it's just across the line.
It's at the head of the class. It was made in 49, but released early in 1950. So it's sort of the head of the class of 1950s movies.
Okay. One of the things we can talk about in our time is this transition from 40s and 50s, and what happens from noir as it goes from the 40s to the 50s. But we'll get to that. Let's get to what is front and center about this film, and that is Thelma Jordon, Barbara Stanwyck. So locate Barbara Stanwyck in her career and this film for us, Foster.
I think this is about midpoint in her history with film noir, and she's often called the Empress of Film Noir. Indelible, of course, is Felix Dietrichson from Double Indemnity,
right,
1944. And this film borrows from that. So it's midway in her career after this film. She makes a number of compelling 50s films. But when you see her in her entrance, all of a sudden she's there at the district attorney's office.
Right.
Dressed very simply, mm-hmm, not provocatively. There's nothing about her appearance, her voice, or manner that signals, she's a femme fatale, because we remember her from the Double Indemnity. Although the year before this, or just recently, she had made Sorry Wrong Number, in which she's not a femme fatale, she's a victim.
Right.
And gives the greatest victim in noir performance I've ever seen. I mean, that's an extraordinary performance. Hal Wallace.
Right.
And he's the producer of this film. So when she appears, you don't know, is she going to be Barbara Stanwyck from Sorry Wrong Number, or is she going to be Barbara Stanwyck from Double Indemnity.
Okay.
So, yeah. Because the iconography is now complicated. Right. She's not always the femme fatale. Right. She's sometimes the victim. And she appears, and my first instinct when I saw the film years ago first was, oh, I want her to be a nice person in this film. And she seems so nice. She speaks very calmly, that beautiful voice she has, dressed so simply and unprovocatively. Maybe this is a different Barbara Stanwyck from Double Indemnity. And you don't know at the beginning, and you're not supposed to know, that's part of the complexity. You don't know, is this character telling the truth? You sort of like her, it's Barbara Stanwyck. Mm. You want her to be telling the truth. I wanted her to be sympathetic. And the extraordinary thing is we find out that she's just as bad as Felix Dixon in many ways, but you sort of end up liking her anyway.
That's also all part of the noir world that, I mean, you've chronicled with such care, because the noir world is inherently an ambiguous one in a number of ways. And the ambiguity can be inside a character about their, you know, their psychology and their suffering, or it can be about what's threatening outside, you know, in the world. And, you know, the noir partakes of something that is very different from action pictures. Action pictures have a lot of suspense in them, you know, as well as a lot of action. But frequently, noir has in it the uncanny, this sense that there's something wrong here. I'm being told that I'm in a right world, or I'm being told that there's nothing wrong here, but I know that there's something that's not right, and, as it were, I can't pin it down. Now, that can be the response of a character in the story world, you know, like a creeping sense of paranoia. Wait a minute, they told me everything's okay, but I don't think it is. I don't think it is. Mm-hmm. Okay, which, by the way, later in the 50s, and you and I agree, becomes Invasion of the Body Snatchers. No, there really is something wrong. They really are
there
snatching
really is
body.
Something wrong.
You know, but here, there's this exactly this oscillation of, where is this going to go?
You don't know in this film.
Okay.
Because the crime scene is really not introduced until about 40 minutes in.
Good point.
That's very challenging, because the film seems to be a kind of study of a marriage that's not successful and this other woman who is very sympathetic.
Right.
And so is this a film noir? Maybe not for the first 40 minutes. And I think people who have some problems with the film talk to its very about its very leisurely pacing.
Right.
It takes a long time to set up the crime scene deliberately, so that it's attacking moral certainties. I think that's what you were talking
about. Yeah, absolutely.
Film noir. Film noir attacks our moral certainty, and good and bad are not quite so, they're not quite so separate categories. They merge, and there's a gray.
Right. And let me just put that in a particular kind of historical context. I was just talking with some students about this, and what I was talking about was the imposition of the production code in 1934, which, when you actually read the code, because it is published and we can read it now, really sets up a world of moral certainties. And film noir is one of the undermining of the code.
That and challenges those moral certainties.
Absolutely. Absolutely, absolutely the case. And finds all kinds of ways to do so. And I think, as you point out so well, this is a film that you're saying, well, okay, is this an adultery melodrama, or is this... I'm not sure.
And it's set up even more subversively than that.
Okay.
Because the wife, played by an interesting actress, Joan Tetzel, is not sympathetic.
Yes.
She's cool. She's aristocratic. She has a faint British accent, though the actress herself is American.
Right.
She's affected. She comes from a wealthy family. She has an impossibly demanding and dictatorial father.
Right.
And you're not sympathetic to her. You see why the Wendell Corey character is unhappy in this marriage. It is not a good marriage.
Right.
And so when this attractive, seemingly sympathetic woman appears as if by magic at his office door, he's open to the situation. He's open to her. And the film makes us understand why he is. It doesn't condemn his attraction. It supports it.
No, absolutely.
I'm attracted to Stanwyck's character. I want them to get together and for him to violate his marriage vows.
Well, and it's been and it's been set up. I mean, it just as you pointed out, it's extremely well chronicled why he feels this way. I mean, we see the background, and so we're thinking, okay, if that's the case, good luck to you, buddy.
Yes.
You know, there's not the hint of the setup, and you bring up this very interesting point. Literally, it's 40 minutes in, and then it is cinematically handled. It's the gunshot behind the closed door.
The gunshot behind the closed door. Of course, we don't see who pulls the trigger. And at that moment, the film goes into high noir chiaroscuro, light and shadow, and all the visual tropes that we love about film noir. They've been withheld, more or less, until then. And then Siodmak and George Barnes, his ace cinematographer, lets us have it. Full-blown noir, full-born noir. And the identity of the shooter enticingly withheld.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Enticingly withheld. Who did it? We don't know. And we're not going to know until near the end.
Right. Absolutely. And so now we're talking about a film in which 40 minutes in until the crime happens, and then the film pivots stylistically into a noir world. And then, coming back to my phrase of a moral ambiguity, but also a story ambiguity, here we're going to go for another 40 or 45 minutes in which we don't know who to trust or what.
We don't know who to trust, but the veils of the Stanwyck character are dropped one by one.
Yes, exactly.
And I remember the first time I saw the film many years ago, I was disappointed each time I found out, oh, she's guilty. Or she certainly appears to be guilty. Oh, she's a femme fatale after all. Right. But we don't see her in full femme fatale regalia ever in the film. Mm. Only in that startling photograph when we see her in the blonde right. wig, and she's clearly a B-girl. She's clearly a femme fatale.
Yeah.
But that's not how she appears in the film. She pretends that she's this refined woman who was a hostess at elegant hotels.
Right.
And Barbara Stanwyck can bring that off. But yet, with Barbara Stanwyck, can I say this? Isn't there always a hard edge underneath?
Yes.
There's a hardness about Stanwyck herself.
Yes. Yes, I mean, and known as a person incredibly well liked and respected in the industry for her utter efficient professionalism, which kind of that hardness of him, she's the person who always came perfectly prepared,
and very cordial to the crew.
Absolutely.
But then after the film, and she seemed to be so friendly to the crew, she would change her phone number so they couldn't reach her.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
yeah.
Barbara Stanwyck was an act in herself. She was masked.
Right.
And that masked quality comes through beautifully in this film. That's what the whole film is about, is revealing what's underneath the mask, behind the mask.
Well, now, this now poses the question that comes up in the very end of the film. So, as you've outlined it so clearly, because I love the idea of the dropping of the veils, because it's so appropriate in every way.
There are a lot of them.
Oh, yeah.
Many veils.
Yeah, absolutely. One after another. So it would seem as if, okay, that act was so, it was a brilliant performance on her part as the nice girl at the beginning. But now we see who she really is. Yet, in the end, she protects him.
In the end, she protects him. She's gallant.
Yeah.
She's heroic. So our reading of her as somehow a decent or even valiant or likable person, not wrong. And she's a killer.
Yeah.
And she's a liar. And she's greedy. She's all the things we expect of a femme fatale. And yet ultimately she's sympathetic and performs a heroic act.
Right.
And she cared for him.
Well, that being the point is that, and she even, you know, talks about it, and it's in the dialogue of, you were not the intended victim, and maybe I would not have changed if I hadn't met you.
That's right. She chooses him. He's there almost by mistake. She's come to see his boss.
Absolutely.
But she likes him. And we feel it, and we learn at the end that when she pretends to like him in the course of the film, there's some truth to that.
Right.
She has romantic feelings for this man.
Yeah. So let's talk about the man.
Yes.
So let's talk about the character and also about Wendell Corey, the actor, because they have great chemistry in the film, but great chemistry doesn't always mean balanced chemistry.
It's not balanced because Barbara Stanwyck is this great charismatic movie star. Wendell Corey just at the beginning of his career, but he doesn't have the same charisma. He doesn't have the same screen presence. He doesn't have the same power. But the weakness inherent in the Wendell Corey iconography suits the character. They're not supposed to be balanced figures.
Right, exactly.
I mean, Robert Mitchum would have been wrong in that part.
Right.
Wendell Corey is exactly right. There's a weakness there. And I've talked about Barbara Stanwyck's hardness in the real world. Wendell Corey had an alcohol problem in the real world.
Right.
So his character's problems with alcohol and what alcohol does to him happened to Corey, and he didn't have the A-list career that
right.
Paramount had hoped he would have, really introducing him in this film with his first lead. And his career tapered off into the second lead, the kind of character he plays in Rear Window.
Right.
Not the hero. Not heroic. Reliable second lead, but with an underlying weakness, and that weakness was his own failed battle with alcoholism.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but this is also a very interesting film to look at from this angle of Stanwyck and the character of Thelma Jordon, but also as we're looking at post-American mores and how America wishes to view itself and portray itself. Now, obviously, the cliche of the 1950s, and let's use the title of the TV show, Father Knows Best.
Yes.
Right.
And there's the cliche of the 50s, and a lot of the inspiration for my book and the major theme of the book is to disabuse readers and viewers of those cliches. The 50s were far more complex.
Right.
Father Knows Best and Ozzie and Harriet. And this film, at the head of the class, reveals that. A marriage that is not restored, isn't it implied that marriage is over at the end?
Yeah.
And divorce was a forbidden subject at the time.
Right.
But this film challenges the status quo in that regard. And it reveals an upper middle class American family that has some rot at the core.
Yeah.
It's anything but an idealized vision. So the film, right? I like the fact that it appears at the head of the class of the 1950s. Announces many of the subversive themes that are going to be discussed and handled throughout the 50s, supposedly this period of good cheer and consumerism and conformity, all cliches.
Well, and let's not forget that portrait of that particularly failed marriage is on the, as it were, the right side of the street. That is, these are the people, they're not portrayed as corrupt, per se.
Not at all.
No, but as flawed for sure. But this is, you know, the cliche would be, well, they have it all. Look, they have the wealth, they have the class position, they're literally on the side of the law. And that's also, I think, as you pointed out, that's also part of the complicating features of this film. So you've got all this stuff that's supposed to be correct, and once you put it under a closer examination, you reveal all kinds of things. It's almost like the thing, well, that's a clean dish, and you put the microscope on it, and you say, no, there's bacteria everywhere.
So the film does not conform to the cliched happy ending that was supposed to be imposed on just about all movies in the 1950s. This is a subversive film in more ways than one.
Yeah. Well, it's such an interesting ending because it's open in the sense that, okay, we know she is dead, but we know he is going to be disbarred. He's left the office even before he seems to be fired, and presumably the marriage.
There's no happy scene between him and his wife at the end, is there?
No, not at all.
Reconciliation. She's nowhere to be seen, and he walks down a dark, noir-stained street.
Yeah.
Into what kind of future? We don't know. It's open-ended. That's also subversive, that the film doesn't tie up all its loose ends. There are questions at the end of the film. What will happen to him? Is his punishment adequate to his crime? Right. He became a criminal co-conspirator, didn't he?
Yeah, well, I'm not a lawyer, nor do I play one on television. but no, you're absolutely correct. And there's one sense in which a further complication is he gets off easy. That is, they could have come down utterly hard on him, and they're letting him, in a certain sense, and I put this in quotation marks, walk away with a destroyed life, as opposed to maybe doing some, you know, a hard time.
Or being brought up on criminal charges.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
He just walks away, but his life is destroyed.
Yeah.
And his future is uncertain.
Yeah.
And the marriage is not repaired, which was a radical gesture for Hollywood 1950.
Right.
And throughout the 50s, there are these radical gestures that disabuse the superficial cliches.
So let's talk about noir as it transitions from the 1940s to the 1950s, with this, in your view, as a kind of pivot film. I mean, very interesting to look at in those, you know, in those ways. So, in what way do you find the 40s films? And we can use, you know, Robert Siodmak is a great noir director with such things as Crisscross and The Killers, among others.
Phantom Lady,
indeed.
And those are all high noir, high expressionism.
Right.
And this film certainly pivots into that expressionist noir territory, but it also has some location shots,
okay,
which become more and more a part of 50s noir, location noir. In the 40s, noir was almost entirely studio created. And a lot of this film is clearly, if you know what to look for, this is Paramount.
Yeah.
I'm pretty good at even identifying that's a Paramount set, that's a Warner set, that's a Fox set, that's an RKO set. Probably blindfolded, I could have said this is a Paramount film. The sets look Paramount-like, but they're location shots. It's
right.
Opened up to the real world in ways that were not common at all in the 40s, and that I think that's pivotal and transitional.
Well,
wonderful outdoor set of the Santa Ana Courthouse.
Yes.
At the end of the film.
Yes.
Real place. And the prison, the women's prison, is L.A. County Jail at the end. That was unusual for
right.
a film noir. That would all have been done in sets. Robert Siodmak was interested, I think, in opening up the noir palette to the real world. And after this film, he made a film that nobody knows that has nothing to do with noir called Whistle at Eaton Falls, about a strike in a factory, and it's almost cinema verite, semi-documentary. No trace of his noir background. So he was clearly interested in expanding his noir palette.
Let's talk a little bit about this, you know, what this change of palette really means thematically, because it seems like the 40s films, are much more internalized.
They're more claustrophobic, they're more enclosed, they're
right.
studio-centered and studio-created.
Right.
When you open film noir to the real world, Barbara Stanwyck made a fabulous film noir called Jeopardy,
right.
which was shot almost entirely on location, set in Mexico and Baja California. And it has a very different look from the 40s noir that were studio-enclosed. So I think this film anticipates that move to location noir, which makes noir much more a part of the real world than the claustrophobic and enclosed noir of the high 40s.
Right. And do you think that also opens noir to an indirect, but nonetheless strongly present, kind of social critique, as opposed to being, you know, in many ways in a chamber world of these, of trapped claustrophobically with these characters?
Absolutely. The high 40s noir were, I like your word, chamber dramas.
Yeah.
No exit, enclosed. The 50s noir tend to open out onto the real world, and then that becomes a critique of America in the 50s. So noir was always subversive. It was always undermining certainty. And it continues to do so, on, I think, on a broader canvas in the 50s.
Right. So let me ask you another question about the 50s and noir, since we've got you here, Mr. 50s.
Yes. and
that is typically now people talk about, and you've written about, noir and the end of noir. Frequently people cite something, Touch of Evil and or Psycho, as, you know, the ending of that big, the big 15 to 20 year cycle. And then neo-noir comes along a bit later with, you know, works like Chinatown, Body Heat, etc., Global. So why does the cycle come to an end? I mean, it has a great run in the 40s and the 50s. What are, it's not one variable, it's multiple variables.
It's multiple variables, but a lot of genres came to an end
okay.
in the studio era. The high melodrama mm-hmm. came to an end with its greatest rendition, Imitation of Life, 1959.
Okay.
I would say classic noir came to a kind of end with the explosion at the end of Odds Against Tomorrow,
okay.
which is 1959.
Right.
So that apocalyptic explosion is certainly a nice ending for classic era noir. We historians like to date things and make things
I've heard rumors about that, sir.
You know, when this begins here and this ends there. Of course, that's never true.
Right.
So there are other entries of classic noir into the
60s. Right.
But by the time you get to 1967 and Point Blank,
right.
which I would put at the head of the class of neo-noir, we're in a different visual and thematic register.
Right.
It's noir,
yeah.
but it's noir evolved.
Noir evolved, or some of us would even, since some of us like, you know, labels too, Point Blank is modernist noir.
Yes,
Point Blank is European art cinema noir that happens to take place in the United States with Lee Marvin, and we both highly recommend because...
Oh, it's a brilliant film and an extremely important film historically, but it allows noir to continue because you can't keep telling the same stories with the same visual idiom
right.
and the same moral concerns over and over again. A genre or a movement lasts if it's elastic, you know, if it can grow and change and evolve, and happily, noir has done that. We call it neo-noir,
right.
but we're still making them. We love them. But the classic era with the end of the 50s, the beginning of the 60s, and the end of black and white, because by the mid-60s, almost every film was made in color. Until then, black and white and color shared the screen.
Okay, we're going to end with the end of black and white and the end of a cycle of noir. If you've enjoyed this particular film, please join us in coming weeks to see more film noir. You can find out about that at our website, www.tv.cuny.edu. Please come there to see what is on City Cinematheque and all of the other programming here on City University Television. Foster, what a pleasure to have you back again. Always a walking encyclopedia of noir and other things. Always a pleasure to have you.
Thanks so much.
Great. And thank you for joining us here on City Cinematheque. And please join us again as we continue our stroll through the archives of film history. Bye-bye for now.